Okay, I'm here with Alyosha Novitsky, the man, the myth, and the legend.
How's it going?
Hey, and we are getting ready. Well, I say we. That's funny, isn't it? Alyosha is getting ready to assemble the payload for the balloon launch. You want to tell them exactly so I don't screw it up?
Well, basically, it's part of a campaign. This is for UAP Society. And the goal of them, of that campaign, is to basically decentralize science. So they're creating DeSci, right, through the Ethereum blockchain and all that kind of stuff. We're going to raise capital, and we're going to be looking for UFOs. And we're going to allow for people to submit proposals, basically. And based on whether or not the society votes the proposal yes or no is whether or not it gets funded. But May 27th, we're doing a launch out of Blind Frog Ranch Outpost out in Utah. And so this launch is going to be a weather balloon launch. And so we need to create the payload. Bang. So what we're doing today is creating a weather balloon payload. And basically for this, I have two different tracking systems. I've got the Spot 3 tracker. And then I also have the StratoFlights tracker. Right, so these are two different GPS systems, each one connected to different satellite systems. And also on board, we have this iPhone that has track my phone capabilities, right? So basically, we have three different tracking systems on board. And then as far as cameras, right, we've got three different cameras. We have the iPhone camera. And then we have, I already started kind of putting this together. This is the Ape Man, right? So this is it's basically like a little GoPro.
I've had one of those. They're a lot cheaper than GoPros too, aren't they?
I'm not sure about that. Basically what's really cool is we connected with a company out in Germany called Strato Flights, I believe. And basically they offered us a system. We bought their packet basically.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, and they're probably gonna be doing a launch out in Germany the same time, right? So we're gonna have two balloons going up, different parts of the world. And just so you guys can see, I have a scale here and I'm weighing all the different parts. So this camera weighs 59 grams.
That was an iPad you were going to mount to the.
Well, it's like this little kitchen scale.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
Probably be very accurate too.
Yeah. So it's good up to 11 pounds and it does it all in grams, accurate to 1 gram. And so basically this, you know, 59 grams. So I wrote down 60. So I weighed every single one of the components. For example, GPS spot tracker weighs 120 grams. It says 118, but I round up. Yeah. The reason I round up is because you want to make sure you have a lot of extra weight capability, basically. This is the Strato tracker coming in at 133 grams. So I might as well say 135. And so basically, after you weigh out all the parts, you have an idea of how much each part weighs, right? Because when you make the balloon, it's a lot like a boat. You want to make sure it's balanced about the center of gravity. Because if you put all your cameras on one side, it's going to go up tilted, right? So you want it to be nice and balanced about the center of gravity. And so one of the components that we're putting in is this iPhone right here, iPhone 7. And it's going to be doing a live stream and it's going to be pointing down, right? So it's going to be on the bottom of the box. The iPhone, I've already traced out where it's going to go.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, the iPhone 7 is going to end up going right here. And then the spot tracker weighs 20 grams less. So it's going to be going on the bottom as well, but a little bit further outward, right? So you want to make sure all your weights are the same. And so basically that's that. That's going to go there.
What was your budget weight that you were shooting for?
It needs to be under 4 pounds. We have a 2000 gram lift capability, right? So that's about 1800 grams.
Hmm. That's pretty good.
Here's a parachute that's going to attach to the box later on as well.
We hope that works.
It'll work. So I'm putting this parachute to the side for now. And on top, what we're going to have is the eight man right here. And we're going to go ahead and trace, as well as the Strato Tracker, right? Both these devices are going on top. And the Strato Tracker weighs quite a bit more than the 8-man. The 8-man was about 60 grams. The Strato Tracker is 130, right? So you want to use your torque equation, force times distance, right? About center of gravity. And so the camera goes out way further, basically, than the Strato Tracker. Easiest way to put it, about twice as far.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Why aren't you putting those on the side so they don't look at the parachute or the balloon when they're looking
up? We have one camera pointing down, which is the live stream. So when we first launch the balloon, this one will be literally live streaming from our event, pointing down at the crowd, and you'll get to see every one of us. The GoPro is going to be our camera that's pointing straight out to the side.
Okay, awesome. Yeah.
And then the camera pointing upward is in order to catch the balloon burst.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Because apparently when the balloon explodes, it's like really, really cool.
I was thinking it's going to be looking at the parachute, the underside of the parachute when it comes down.
It will be looking at the underside of a parachute when it comes down.
That's where I'm going to put my advertising, right?
That's pretty funny. That's actually...
you should sell that spot to an advertiser.
That's a good Easter egg, and that's pretty much, pretty sure, most likely going to be a Lucius Labs logo.
There you go. Yeah, surprise.
There's going to be a lot of random Easter eggs. For example, that is one of them. And what that is a stamp.
So first class postage?
Yeah, well, it's like L squared.
Oh, okay. Oh, Lucius Labs?
Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah. I stamp up a lot of stuff with this.
Plus, if aliens actually steal this thing before it gets to the ground, then...
Well, when people realize that 2 squared is equal to 1, this logo will mean a lot more to them as well.
That's pretty cool.
There's a lot going on with the logo. We'll just put it that way. But we need to trace these out, right? We're going to install them. And so Strato Tracker is going to be up here. This is going to be right here. I'm going to not cut out the location for the Strato Tracker now. I'm going to save that later. But right now what I'm going to do is cut out the location of the 8-man. So we'll go ahead and make a cut, right? But in order to know what to cut, I need to basically trace it.
So... Jason Silverberg had a funny question and then a serious question. He said, "Well, this disproves flat Earth, and there's nothing nothing can disprove the flat Earth to flat Earthers. You could take them up in the spaceship themselves personally, and they would still say the Earth was flat."
That's actually a really good question, because at what height do you actually start to see some curvature, right? And from my last balloon flight, I was able to capture some really nice images. I did this one about 9 years ago, and I did this with, believe it or not, you know, those cameras you like roll and you like, it's a disposable camera. You roll it, you click it.
Like the kind I grew up with.
Yeah. I basically attached one of those to a timing circuit. So it took a picture every 35 seconds.
Oh, no way.
Yeah. Oh,
wow. That's
so awesome. This shows curvature, in my opinion. I feel like the Earth is curved in this photo.
I think the highest I've ever been is 30,000. What does an airplane, what does a jet fly?
About 35,000, yeah. This is.
Yeah, you can see the curvature in a, you know, when you're flying.
That's 120,000 feet right there.
Yeah, this balloon's going to go 120,000 feet. So you should easily be able to see. Oh, and he's also asking, what's the purpose of the experiment?
The purpose of this specific launch is to create attraction, essentially, for the UAP Society, which is raising capital through an NFT campaign as well as a GoFundMe campaign right now, so that we can basically fund decentralized scientific research. But as far as what this payload is going to carry, it's also kind of a surprise. We're putting on one of Jim, I believe his last name is like Senegal. He was on season 1 of Skinwalker Ranch. He created this device, basically. in order to basically measure the electromagnetic fluctuations from radio to like gamma waves. And we're putting one of those devices on here as well. And it's going to be going up. So this launch will have one of his devices on it.
When is he sending that?
I'm sorry, what's that?
When is he sending it?
Oh, I'm going to meet with him in Utah.
Oh, okay. So he's going to bring it with
him. Yeah, we're meeting in Utah at the end of the month.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, I'm trying to find my knife right now.
While you're doing that, I put the link to the UAPsociety.com, website up there, and also put the GoFundMe. And I've contributed to that. I think it's awesome. The main thrust is to fund this through the sale of NFTs, but it's not a bad idea to have a backup plan or supplemental dollars. So that's what the GoFundMe is for. And I don't know what it's up to. I need to go see. Chris is trying to raise, it's up to $925 out of 6,000. So I think one of the things that's kind of cool about this whole project is that one of the goals is to create open source science and to decentralize the results of scientific experiments.
Exactly, because a lot of companies, honestly, they just keep everything private and they want to use it as power, right? Because for some reason, having knowledge is power, right? And it really comes down to trust and lack of trust if they're saying it's all for national security. Because the only reason you wouldn't give the information out to the public is because you don't trust them.
Well, and see, the problem with traditional science is this, and I have experience with this because I did some volunteer work for the Galileo Project. They want to collect all their data, right, and then filter it. And I don't mean filter in a mean way. I just mean they want to filter out the noise, right? So they want to take their scientific research, their data, and filter it, and then disseminate it to where it can be peer reviewed, I suppose.
Yeah, they have their process,
Yeah, and it's kind of frustrating because I remember when I was volunteering, I asked them if I could make YouTube videos, and they kind of hesitated. And then, anyway, that's a long story. But I kind of get the idea that the whole gist behind it is to be more open source. The UAP Society should be a more transparent. I kind of get why, some groups of scientists want to keep their, information kind of close to their chest until at some point they're ready to release it. But I get the impression, and you can tell me, Alyosha, if I'm correct, that this will be more transparent as far as the results from the science that's performed.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense that they want to hold on to their, I mean, how, it has everything to do with money as well. It's like, how do you get funding if you're just giving away all your information?
No, I get it. That's what I'm saying. I get it. And I understand. I wasn't criticizing them. Right? I think it's cool. It's an awesome thing. But I think this takes it to a different level. The UAP Society should be a different thing, which is exciting. And Elena said, I'm so excited to grab an NFT. This is the first DAO of its kind. Yeah. And I'm going to grab one too whenever it's released. Oh, that's what, 1.5 inches thick. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's pretty thick cardboard. And they say to make sure to leave some good spacing around your equipment for two reasons. Basically, one of them is so it doesn't overheat, because it's going to get hot within this 1.5 inch foam. And the second reason is for your plug, because you need to be able to plug in your batteries and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah. A practical reason.
Yeah, exactly. And so the second half, I already did this little part. I cut out, I basically traced the camera again, as well as the power button, just so we know what's going on, right?
Oh, so the cardboard's going to be taped on top.
Yep. So now
that's cool.
So now I basically insert A into B, right? Like, just like that. And so now I have a camera pointing straight up. And what they do here is just pretty simple. You get your fancy duct tape. This is just, I'm going to actually cut this a little bit because I don't like how it's overhanging. So I'm going to give it a quick cut.
I didn't see how you attached it to the cardboard.
Oh, so basically I have it sized perfectly to where the aperture of the lens fits right through the hole.
Oh, that's what's holding it. I thought you were performing.
Yeah, it's literally held by the aperture.
I had double-sided tape or something.
No, what we do before we launch, though, we're going to end up taping the camera to it. Right? But at least right now I can still access the power button.
Right.
But point being is that I didn't like how there was overhang. So I'm going to go ahead and trim that just a little bit.
I still wish there were more cameras on the side, but that's just
We potentially have another GoPro coming out, and I do think we have the ability for some more weight. So we'll see how that goes. But kind of fun. You know, this is a promo launch.
And yeah.
So we were talking about potentially putting in some items, right? Like Chris mentioned, he wants to throw in some socks into the box so he can walk around with socks that say they've been to space. We'll see how that plays out. But what I'm getting at is I have these cool
washes in before he puts them in there.
I have these. These are made of copper, made by my mom, actually. And maybe I'll put a couple of these in there, and they'll go to space.
Can you put an artisan patch in there? If I send you one?
It needs to be very – yeah, so we'll get, like, a patch in there. It's got to be lightweight, you know?
It's very light, see?
And so what you can see here is I have the lid cut out. I have – this cardboard cutout, I'm going to lay that on top and just make sure that the camera can fit in it, basically. So I'm going to put the camera back in it before I put the, I missed one step. Hold on. Let me get this duct tape going. You know, balloons to space don't just build themselves.
You can't just mail order them from Amazon.
Actually. yeah, I might set that up. But so what I'm doing here is the cardboard basically has like little frizzies that come off. And so in order to prevent any type of interference with the camera lens, get some tape. And basically, I'm going to make like little patches around that.
Yeah, Mick West will be saying that UFO we record is a cardboard anomaly.
At that point, it's identified. That's a use... It's an ICO, it's an unidentified cardboard object. That's funny.
So there's a device that also automatically releases so that the parent, right? That it, what is it?
Well, relying on the auto cutter. Well, we're gonna rely on the balloon burst altitude.
But the balloon, right, but the balloon needs to detach itself from the
balloon will pop.
Right, but then it doesn't it get in the way if it doesn't detach, doesn't it get in the way of the parachute?
No, well, I mean, they've never really had a problem with that, but apparently, like, the balloons basically disintegrate. They're covered in, like, a special powder, so once they pop, the whole thing just disintegrates.
I was thinking about the structure that holds the...
It's just going to be a string.
Oh, huh. Okay. So I have this big, you know, thing, you know, like cargo straps in my mind, holding, you know, going up to the balloon.
No, it's literally, so that's
sandbags hanging over
the requirement when it comes to making balloons. The string, any part of the balloon needs to be able to break at a certain strength, right? So any cords need to break within under 50 pounds of force.
Hmm.
Like any string you use needs to be extremely lightweight, basically.
So that rules out my 4x4 toe strap for my truck.
Yeah, we're not going to be using that. But you never know. Maybe it'll come in handy if I get stuck out in the middle of nowhere looking for this thing.
That's true. You could use it as a rappelling device too. If you had to go off a cliff to get it. I have all the these images in my head of Alyosha going through the jungle, fighting lions and tigers, trying to find it.
I'm preparing for mountain lion.
That's probably not a bad idea, actually, because you're going to be in that territory, right?
Yeah, that's the only one that actually concerns me. Well, also bears, but more the mountain lion.
I've seen plenty of bears, no mountain lions, but the bears are smarter. You know, bears are smarter than mountain lions, and they will go the other direction faster than a mountain lion will, I think.
A mountain lion will try to eat you. Have you seen the videos of them, like, attacking bike riders?
Yeah. You have to back away slowly and never turn your back on them. And
when people watching this, don't say anything about that L square stamp, right? That's a hidden Easter egg.
You covered it up.
I put that on every project I make.
Yeah, Chris will charge you for it, for putting it on there, right, if he sees it.
We'll be all right.
Chris Lato is, I guess, the project creator and another cool guy. Well, that looks professional.
Hey, man, what I do. So basically, you have that, right? And that's there. And with this one, I mean, I think I want to use the spot tracker on top with it. And so the spot tracker, though, it needs to be completely free of interference. And so they suggest to mount it on the outside of the box. Right? That's what they say to do. So that's what I'm going to do.
Yes, Elena, it does have GPS. It's funny, she asked the question before you start talking about the tracker. It'll have three different devices, three, you know, sort of a trifold backup system as far as tracking it. The phone, the iPhone is going to be mounted on the bottom, and two GPS devices, which the ones I've had before, you could track live.
Yeah, this is live tracking, all three of them. So basically, this is called the Strato Tracker. Each one of them has their own SIM card. This is the Strato Tracker. Came from Germany. This is the Spot 3, highly recommended by outdoor enthusiasts.
Yeah, I've seen those before.
Yep, and then here's basically the iPhone that has, you know, Find My iPhone.
The least reliable of all three of them, but
it's probably going to be the one that's easiest to use, honestly, because it's already linked to my other phone and it works perfectly.
I mean, as far as cell service, that's all I mean. The others are
ones send out signals only when they receive satellite data. Like, so these are better for out in the wilderness where there's no cell towers.
Yeah, that's what I was saying. That those are based on satellite signals, and the phone's based on cell signals.
Exactly.
So I don't imagine. Once you get above 30,000 feet, you may actually lose the phone signal.
So you can see that I'm basically just aligning it here. I'm putting it a little bit more inward because the camera was pretty lightweight. So I'm going to put the GPS like a little more to the inside. And basically right here, I'm punching a hole. And on this side, I'm doing the same thing.
If Tony or anyone knows, has he done a vid where he goes in detail into his experience? You talking about mine or Alyosha?
This is some thick carb styrofoam.
I noticed that when you cut the hole out, I was like, wow, you know, I'm used to dealing with this 3/4 inch, 1 inch stuff, and that's looks like it's like 1.5 inches.
Yeah, this is real thick. I mean, that took some working. So that one's good. That one's good. And what's really nice about the kit that we bought is that everything is within the standards, right? The recommendations and all that. And so this is the rope. Your big truck strap.
Truck strap.
That I'm using.
Oh, Angry Drunken German is talking about, he was asking me about my experience. I don't know. I guess I could talk about it briefly, but I don't want to take away from Alyosha's, you know, building this thing.
Well, you know, two holes, actually.
Basically, when I was 12 years old, I'm not making any claim, and I don't talk about it much because I'm afraid people will think I'm making a claim that I'm an experiencer, and I'm not. It was just an experience. And It made, but it did make me question everything from then on. And I got myself in trouble a lot at church from the age of 13 to now. But it's fine. Just curious if you can read where it talks. Maybe that's what I'll do sometime. But it just really, just briefly, it was just basically, I mean, people call them orbs now. I didn't know what they were called back, you know, back in those days. When I was young, we didn't have terminology really. We had, the only terminology we had was, you know, UFOs, right? So this was like a ball of light. It was like, had a trance. Here's the spooky thing, okay? It was, and I told, and Alyosha can verify this. I told him this when I first met him. It was like the experience that Chris just described in a video that he did, where it had, there was a gray square, a cube inside of a translucent sphere, right? I didn't see anything inside of this translucent sphere, but it was giving off light, but it wasn't like light that created. How do you describe this? Where you know there's ambient light, but there's no, like, it's not like a flashlight where you see beams of light. Does that make sense?
You talking to me?
Yeah.
I guess so.
I mean, you know, when you see light, you see glare off of it at night. There's glare. There's beams of, you know, there's like, this was just light. It was like, and you could see inside, the source of light was inside this translucent thing, but there was no glare or anything. And it wasn't like it wasn't causing a light on the wall, you know, like a flashlight would. There was no spot. It was just ambient light anyway. And so I was in shock. I saw in my vision was that screen, like the old black and white television where it's all like just noise, and then the next thing I know, I'm waking up in the morning. So I didn't know what it was. I assumed it was, you know, when I got older, that it was like a hallucination, and I never told anybody about it, not even my parents. But it made me start questioning everything, you know, religion and society structure, you know, all that. Anyway, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to go into much detail.
No, I think that's what they're asking, right?
Yeah, but I didn't want to take away from this live stream.
I think it's cool to have conversation like this, you know, when we're building.
Yeah.
That's kind of what we're doing, is destigmatizing UFOs as well, right? Because a lot of people are very scared to talk about their experiences because it's been so shunned upon. It's been so taboo, in quotes.
Yeah, I mean, now I don't feel like I can affect anybody else now. I'm old, you know, my kids are all grown and moved out, so I don't have to worry about embarrassing them. You know, I'm just a crazy old man now living in the woods, so that's, you know, that's what's expected of me, I guess. But what's funny is my mother was this kind of, she was the same, right? She came out of the mountains of East Tennessee, but she was like a world traveler. She would go all over the place, and she would come back and influence me. You know, she would, you know, with Hinduism and Buddhism and Jainism and all these, you know, so I was exposed to this. And she was also in charge of the exchange students in our local area. So I got to meet all these college students from all over the world. And they had their own experiences as far as spirituality and, you know, belief systems. So I was pretty much a... You know, I would get in trouble in my little Sunday school classes for questioning things. But anyway, you know, that's.
I mean, it's pretty simple. I didn't tie it on perfectly tight just now. I'm not cutting the strings because I still need to take it out, put batteries in it before we launch.
Yeah, I wonder what that's rated to as far as temperature goes.
Yeah, apparently it might freeze up when it goes up,
but it should thaw out when it comes back down, right?
Yeah, but they've all the videos I've seen have just shown the spot tracker exposed.
That's cool. Well, that's good.
apparently it's a pretty hardcore piece of equipment that can withstand cold, you know? So that's the space for that. is the space for that. Basically, this is the lid. I still need to make parachute holes.
Alyosha has, they're saying, they're angry drunken Germans asking about your experiences. And he has a lot more than he has time to talk about, right? Or I don't want to speak for you.
I've had experiences my entire life.
Yeah. I mean.
Yeah. From all the way, I guess, from nuts and bolts type of things to purely consciousness experiences. Yeah. But you could say it started when I was like very young, like 10 years old. And what's an easy way to put it?
I don't know. I have always been drawn to the woods for some reason. Even when I was a teenager and in my 20s and 30s, we would do nothing but our pastime was backpacking. And my brother had this Native American friend that they actually ran off and joined the army together. But when we used to have these camping trips, deep in the woods of the Appalachian Mountains, and he would do these, I guess he was into his Native culture. Because he would sit, sort of cross-legged, like he would think it was. He thought it was yoga, but he was really some sort of Native American thing. And he had a little chant he would do, and I swear to Jesus, fog would roll in. And I'm sure it was just a coincidence, but it seemed like he was very in tune with his Native American culture. And his name was Tony also. It's kind of funny. And Tony Palmer. I don't know where he is in life now. Tony, if you're out there, but he and my brother were a wild bunch. My brother was older than me, and they both joined the army at the same time, and they got into all kinds of crazy stuff, I'm sure. But I don't know how that ties into UAPs, so I better hush. Same here.
So right now, basically, I'm making a string for the parachute to attach to. And that's going to be, through the lid as well.
I guess the only reason I brought that up about my brother was that when you have these kinds of experiences, it's almost like you're on some kind of quest. And my brother, when he got out of the military, he joined these, contractor groups, which was very dangerous. And but it was almost like he couldn't be satisfied with just normal life. And I see this a lot in some of the vets I know. Normal life is very strange to them when they come back. And I imagine it might be the same with people who experience paranormal, that it's hard to look at life the same as like a normal person. But I'm imagining this. Okay. I don't know this for a fact.
What's normal, right? So normal is something everyone tries to be.
Which a lot of people try to do, right? They try. Yeah, are you sure that thing's going to... What? That's probably like the twine that we use in construction that is really stronger than you think it is, right? It's like you could pull somebody up a mountainside with it, but it looks...
Yeah, really and thin. Also, I mean, you got to think about it. This payload's only going to be... It's less than 4 pounds.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you really don't need like anything crazy by any means. But what I'm doing right now is so I just put this string through. But what you'll realize the string can cut through cardboard pretty quickly or styrofoam.
Yeah.
So I make like little rings of tape around the holes.
That's actually smart because if any kind of weight at all would pull that string right through the styrofoam, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Or the wind, pushing it back and forth and stuff like that.
And so, we have a smart engineer putting this thing together, guys. Okay.
Doing that there. Putting this one's already running through a piece of tape, so I probably don't need to do it there. I'm gonna go ahead and put one here. And then I also need to put them on the bottom of the lid.
So Few says tuning in a little late. Either of you mind elaborating? Alyosha is building the payload for a balloon that's going to be launched for an event the 27th
Yeah, it's a fundraiser.
And you can go into the link is at the top. I think that I pin it, but anyways, near the top, and it will, it's the website, UAPsociety.com, and also the GoFundMe. The main source of fundraising will be the sale of NFTs, which will be kicked off on the 27th. But the secondary funding source is a crowdfunding event, which is on the GoFundMe, in the GoFundMe link, which is, he's trying to raise $6,000. And I think that's a modest amount. That's an honest
amount. Very modest. Yeah, I think.
Yeah. Chris has put a lot of his own money into this project. So,
yeah.
He's certainly not trying to make money from the public. I mean, well, he's going to be offering the NFTs, which is a pretty decent, from the artwork that I've seen, the artwork is some of the best for the NFTs that I've ever seen on any other. It's not your normal NFT that you think of, the little pixelated people.
So yeah, it's going to be some work.
Yeah, they put major work into the artwork for the NFTs.
Well, I think he's gone through a couple different versions, and it's, you know, you think you're going in the right direction, and all of a sudden you have to adjust, and it's kind of happened a few times maybe at this point, to where now he's got artwork that everyone is on board with.
Yeah, you know, obviously art's one of those things that's the most difficult to produce for a project, because everybody has their own vision, right, of what art is or should be.
Well, but I think too is that the artwork is cool, but that's not even really the important part of the project, right? The important part is raising capital for decentralized science and education, because All the other projects are right now, whether coming from some type of a university, institute, or government, all their knowledge is kept hidden from the public. What we're doing is literally decentralized science and education. So all this information that we gather, first of all, the NFT will be used to fund publicly thought up ideas. For example, if I have an idea, I can pitch it to the UAP Society and we can say, yes, let's fund it. And that information will be made public, right? So it's not going to be hidden. It's decentralized education, decentralized proposals.
The art is the bonus that you're getting, right? Because the value of that could go up in the future.
Well, yeah, exactly. So, yeah, that's the whole NFT thing for sure.
Yeah. So I think the comment I was making about the art being so cool is that you're not only funding this project, you're getting, you know, the possibility of, you know, better, you know, good, decent investment in the future, for the future.
Definitely. So, I think some of the NFTs have like increased in value, like originally sold for like maybe $300, now worth like $100,000, like ridiculous increases in value.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's a way to, not only that, but every time the artwork sells, 7% of it goes to the original artist and group, right? So every time the NFT sells in the future, that capital goes towards the UAP Society, which allows for projects like this. Like on this balloon, we're going to have a piece of equipment that's going to detect all kinds of different electromagnetic frequencies, and variations and scalar waves and things like that. And so this is the step right here to decentralized education and experimentation and publicly traded knowledge, and true disclosure, you know.
There won't be anything classified that comes out of this science.
Exactly.
Yeah. Angry Drunken German says, I'm not a fan of NFTs, but I love the cause. Well, there was some input on that, and that's why I was happy to see the GoFundMe, because, you know, it allows people to, you know, who want to just support it, to be able to do that. And that's, you know, it's that simple, you know. So I like the two pronged approach on the funding. It's awesome.
Definitely.
Yeah.
And so now I have a camera. I have a GPS tracker. And I have my parachute cords.
So how does it detach? Oh, you're saying the balloon. Okay, so the balloon, how does the, so the thing that attaches the balloon to that is not going to interfere with the parachute.
Yeah, the parachute now, I'm not installing it now, but basically you just saw that string I held up. That attaches to the parachute, and the parachute attaches to the balloon.
But the part that attaches the parachute to the balloon is not going to be, it doesn't get in the way of the parachute.
It's a thin string.
Oh, okay. Yeah, see, I still have
imagine the payload. So it's something like this, but stretched out. And then you have this thin string right here coming up to a balloon.
Oh, so it'll just basically be the string hanging.
The string will be dangling like this, probably.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, I'm not too concerned about that. I haven't seen anywhere of like the string getting somehow tangled up and making a knot. And
yeah, and I'm not trying to jinx it either.
yeah, exactly.
It'll be my fault. Yeah. The string wrapped around the parachute.
We're going with a pretty big balloon. This is a 2,000 gram balloon. And this whole box is a one balloon. And at ground level, when it gets filled up, it's going to be at a 2 meter diameter. This is the neck of the book. Oh, I shouldn't be touching
it. So like 7 feet or so?
Yeah, so like it's going to have a 7 foot or so diameter when we're inflating it on ground. But when it bursts, it's going to be at a 12 meter diameter. So 36 feet across when it finally bursts.
That's almost like 38 feet, right? 3.3 something feet per...
Yeah, so closer to 38.
Yeah, no, I'm just trying to imagine how big it's going to be. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, so I'm basically, so that's the lid. And just so you guys can see the lid kind of, here we have the eight man. It gets attached here, taped in place. Right, so we have our spot tracker, our camera, and our strings here attached to the parachute. And everything gets taped shut as well. So like before we launch, this whole thing gets taped up together, right?
Then the tracker, is it taped down? How is it?
I attached the tracker with this set of string here.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Yeah.
Makes me want to put duct tape over it. It's funny.
Well, I have to put the batteries in, so I'll probably tape it across one time.
Oh, that makes sense.
Just do something simple like that.
Now, I've had those trackers, not that exact kind before, but I had to have a subscription temporarily to be able to track it live.
Yes. So I have a subscription to that. And then I also had, so with the spot tracker, basically you need to go on spot tracker, find my spot or something, findmespot.com.
Yeah.
Set up an account and then you get the spot tracker app. With the Strato tracker, basically you go to a cell phone store, get a SIM card, install a SIM and connect it to your service, and then you have something on your phone called the Strato Tracker app that you use.
I wonder how many users, do they allow more than one person to track it?
I think you can have more than one person tracking it. Yeah,
that, you know what would be awesome is if I could track it live.
Yeah, we'll see how that works out. I still need to get finalized setting this up, but yeah, so basically this is like the Strato Tracker app, right?
Yeah,
and then you go to. I don't even know fully yet. I don't have it fully set up just yet. But then with the iPhone 7, you just use the find my device thing, right? So this already has the built-in GPS. So let's move forward. Bam, bam. I'm going to have to vacuum my floor because I'm getting styrofoam on the ground. And so I already marked out where my cell phone's going to go on the bottom here, as well as the Strato tracker.
So how are you gonna attach the cell phone?
The same way I did this GoPro.
Oh, yeah. That seems pretty secure.
Yeah, it's going to get taped in again before the launch and stuff. But this is just like, this is the aperture hole, this power button. So basically,
Because, you know, the nice thing about the styrofoam is worst case scenario, if the parachute fails, you know, at least the styrofoam will protect the equipment a little bit from shock.
It's going to be falling from space. I don't know how I'm gonna...
Well, it'll reach terminal velocity, though, right? What, 120 miles, 30 miles? For a human,
sprawled out like this. I think if you're dive bombing position, you can hit 170.
Really?
Yeah, you're more aerodynamic.
You might have to take a dryback to vacuum all the little styrofoam balls.
So here's you know, a little blade just to get this cut started.
And what is the launch trying to achieve? It's a media event for the launch of the NFTs, which are going to help fund. Is that correct? The launch is a sort of a it's just a fun way to kick off the event, you know, to kick off the whole project.
Yeah, we're doing it's well, it's to show that we're actually like out there doing stuff, right? And so we actually have equipment on here that will be listed for UAP. And it's in a pretty UAP hotspot too, out in Utah, in Vernal, which is that whole area apparently is a paranormal highway. And I mean, to compare it to more familiar trip landmarks, you could say it's 20 miles north of Skinwalker Ranch. So it's like that whole area. And potentially this could even fly over Skinwalker Ranch, which might be exciting.
There's a whole basin there that's got activity, right? It's not just Skinwalker Ranch, right? It's the
right. It's that whole
valley, whole valley area, whole basin. And I forgot what Indian tribe or what the reservation is there, but that apparently has something to do, possibly. I've heard theories about.
And I need to get that vacuum. That was a lot of styrofoam.
Just rub your feet on the floor really fast. If you've got carpet, it'll all stick to you.
I should probably just roll around on the ground. Is that a bad joke? So here is, you know, the bottom of the box now. Basically, I just put a big, huge hole in the bottom. And here's the phone, right? So you can see that the phone fits in the hole, basically. And so what I'm going to do now is put a piece of cardboard across here. And then cut out a hole for where the camera goes. So what I want to do is get a piece of cardboard. So put this aside for now. Here's a piece of cardboard from one of my balloon time boxes. And, you know, I can get my pen, trace out the iPhone here, basically. So I have like a rough shape of it. And then my lens is up here, right? So what I'm gonna do is actually just make like a little square. That's where my lens is gonna be sticking out of. Just made it really easy to trace out there. I'm gonna pretty it up a little bit here. Cool. So I need to cut out this hole now, basically. For that, I have a box knife. You know, one of these little box cutters.
Angry Jack and German says, I was going to mention that. They have launched things that caused clocks to vary. You mean the Skinwalker Ranch?
I noticed that one of their last episodes, they showed all the GPS signals were getting thrown off, which is something that could really mess us up. If all the GPS starts to act all funny.
Hopefully the wind will carry you a little bit out of the area.
Well,
because there's like a,
you know, it doesn't have, we don't have predictions all the way to May 22nd as far as the wind in that area, but the current flight path prediction shows it landing almost in the middle and somewhere in Colorado. So straight east of where we're launching.
Yeah. Our weather, it should, Ours comes from the Gulf and goes northeast, or from the southwest and goes northeast. But the from what I've seen, that their Skinwalker Ranch is claiming like a triangle of an area that has the magnetic anomalies.
And it's right now, I'm gonna duct tape this phone to the. I heard there was there's like a couple different areas, right, that have the anomaly.
Yeah, what I saw was they've identified three points that they've actually measured, and those three points make kind of a triangle. I don't know if that's still a thing, but from the past shows, that's what I've seen.
Cool. Yeah, so right now, basically, just to like avoid any frizzies getting in the way, I'm putting little bits of tape, making like a, see like this little frizzy right there, I want to get rid of that, put a little bit of tape there. I call them frizzies. I'm not sure what the technical name is, but so I'm going with.
Fuzzies.
Things, little hairs in the way of the camera, basically.
I haven't actually watched any of the Skinwalker Ranch programs. First of all, I don't know where they're being shown, so that's kind of dumb, I understand. But secondly, I was kind of waiting. My sort of barometer is if something really, interesting happens, it should end up on the major news outlets. So I'm waiting for that drop of evidence that makes it out of Skinwalker Ranch and out of the TV program. That's what I'm waiting on. So I don't actually watch it.
So makes sense.
Yeah. If it just, so I'm waiting. I want a video of a dino beaver before I invest too much time and money in it. I would rather invest money in UAP Society than subscribing to a channel that shows. I don't even know where they're playing it, so I should be quiet. But, you're speaking of the Bermuda Triangle. Yeah. Well, that's cool.
So I'll be able to get the cell phone going. Aperture out, right? So now I'm going to cut this down just a little bit, just so that it's not so obtrusive. And like on the balloon, every bit of weight matters. If we want to put more socks in there or whatever we're going to put in there, we need to make sure we have weight. Like just cutting off that strip alone means I can put a necklace in there, kind of thing.
So something being on the news does not make it more likely to be true. No, but if the only source of the information is from Skinwalker Ranch, I could say the same thing. The source making a claim needs to be verified by other parties. So that's my point. It's right. It's not that I trust the news channel. It's that I want to see another source. Being reporting it. So phone peanuts for packing. That's not a bad idea. So where's the button on my camera button is down at the bottom when I turn on the camera.
Yeah, I'm gonna have to hit the button here, go to camera. But this is actually gonna be a live stream.
Oh, so you're gonna just start the like YouTube app or whatever?
I'm just gonna go to a link. Basically, I'm going to get a text message. So I'll open up my text and I'll hit open.
Oh, because yeah. Is it UCR that's going to live stream it?
Yeah, you, Luis from Jimenez.
Yeah, yep. I guess they're going to do it on UCR's channel.
I think we're doing it on UAP Society.
Oh, okay. Oh, that makes more sense, doesn't it?
Yeah, we started up a new channel called UAP Society, because Chris had it all on his stuff at first. Then someone else had some stuff going out.
I need to get the link to that and put it in the chat.
So if we end up making a cool video of this, it'll end up going up there, you know, like a cool promo video or something.
It's called UAP Society. UAP Society.
It's fairly new. I think it only has like 40 subscribers at the moment.
That's why I was going to put the link in the... That's the link to the YouTube channel. I like the foam peanuts for packing idea. Because if the parachute did fail, they would absorb some internal shock.
It would definitely help out. Let's see if I get the camera open and then put it up to that camera so you guys can see what I see. Oh, well, there's a piece of tape in the way.
But you can see how I have the camera open.
And so yeah.
Yeah.
That's going to be awesome. Just make sure it's not flipped around where you're looking at the inside of the box.
Yeah, that's pointing down.
I know, but you can turn the camera around accidentally.
Right? Oh, I know.
You can have it flipped where it's showing the internal.
Yeah. That's funny.
I'm just trying to think of all the things that can go wrong. And if I was doing it, right? If I was launching it.
Well, for sure.
It should be called Tony's Law, not Murphy's Law.
And so right here, just so we can see what the system is starting to look like.
Don't wait for science. Make it. That's exactly right.
GPS tracker. 8-man. Chute coming up.
And what was the device? What was the sensor, the other sensor that you don't have yet? What was it for?
iPhone. You're talking about this guy.
No, you said someone was going to meet you, was going to have a sensor there at when you met, but right before you launch it, they were going to.
Jim, he's got it. And basically the way I'm going to set that up, it's going to be really easy because we want to get data live time. So there's still plenty of space inside the box. You can see that everything's basically not even sticking into it. We have a battery pack that goes inside, which I'll be getting while we're out there. And then Jim has a device. It's basically, it's like this wide and it makes like an L shape. So I'll be able to just kind of put it in the box. And that connects to the hotspot that's on the cell phone. Yep.
Oh, okay. I thought it was some sort of sensor.
It's a complete system. It's got all kinds of stuff on it.
Oh, okay.
That's yeah, cool. Yeah. It's a device. It's a
data. Is that the Raspberry?
What?
Is that the Raspberry, the little board, the little that I think Chris was talking about?
I don't know exactly what it's called, but this is something that is a good way just to think about it. It's basically going to end up being like something like this.
Yeah, that's the Raspberry. That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, so it's going to end up being something like this, but it has another little part that comes up and a couple more little things that dangle from
it. Yeah, and those little boards, you can solder on sensors and all kinds of things.
Right.
And then you just have to flash the little BIOS or whatever, and it'll run them.
And so that's going to be for the GoPro. So I'm just going to go ahead and make that final cut right now. Just so everything's cut out, but I don't have the actual GoPro with me. So I'm going to have to connect the GoPro to the cardboard, do these last little steps. The day of the event, apparently. That's what's happening.
Nick wants to know, does the GPS tracking work at maximum altitude, which I guess is 120,000?
I'm not sure about that. Honestly, I think that they go out of range and then they regain range on the way down, like once you get back into the height of it. But I don't 100% know. We'll find out how good they work. So, yeah.
Because the... the satellites don't have like 180 degree line of sight to the Earth, right? I mean, at some point you get above that range that satellites can even track, right?
Right. I'm going to go ahead and take the phone off though right now. Well, I can leave the phone on, but I'll be taking it. I'm taking it out before I actually do the launch. But I'm just going to make this cut. And then, I mean, that might be pretty much it for now, actually. You know what I'm saying? I think that might be a good stopping point until I get the GoPro.
So just for people who might have come in, you'd get too far away from the cell towers. Yeah, we're not expecting the cell phone to be active, I don't think, the whole time. I wouldn't think.
No.
Yeah. But before we stop or go, I wanted to remind people that all the links are in the chat. I put them in early, so you might have to scroll up to see the UAPsociety.com, the website, the GoFundMe page is up there, and then on down more recently is the YouTube channel, UAP Society YouTube channel. I'm kind of a noob at producing any kind of live streams, but this is some serious stuff we're talking about. And it's the people who are behind this is a pretty awesome team. You know, I can just tell you that right now. Alyosha here, you know, you've got top notch people, quality people. And I'm just saying, don't be afraid to invest in something like this or contribute, because it's not your typical project.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate that. Yep, everyone, you know, knows what they're doing. And I wanted to just show this last little system here, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to have to switch. So our balloon is a big balloon. And apparently there's a helium shortage going on because there's a war, and there's like people are still recovering from COVID, and the helium mine ran dry. So the primary source and what all the places are basically suggesting to do is to get these little balloon time canisters. And we're going to have to use a couple of them is the point. And we're going to have to switch from different canister to different canister while we're filling up these balloons. So I basically made a really simple system here. This hose basically attaches straight to this little canister. What I have here is a valve, right, that allows the air to keep going forward. And basically, let's see, I'll fill up this balloon a little bit. All right, pretend that's a giant weather balloon. Well, hold on a second. I gotta open the valve.
You gotta test it now before you do it in real life. Well, right?
That's where we're gonna have a guy. His job is to literally hold the balloon to this tube, right? That's his job. Another guy's job is to turn this valve. My job, right? So now we ran out of air with that can. Let's just pretend like I ran out of air. We can flip the valve. We can go get a new canister. We can hang out. We can go have tea. We can do whatever we want. We have all day. This has been like this for 2 days now, so this valve is good. And basically, now let's just pretend like I got a new can out, right? So new can, attach it to my little tank down here, open valve, blow it up more.
I saw you leaning away.
I don't know the popping diameter.
Gonna blow off. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
That's funny.
So now, yeah, I mean, here's my balloon.
Put that in your mouth and talk.
You want to see it?
Yeah.
I feel like that's not appropriate.
Oh man.
You know, I'm a responsible individual here. You want to see
it? It may be some kind of weird helium.
Maybe just see. I didn't do the whole breath, so it's
yeah.
Not, yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
I do like the whole breath.
I'm just kidding. I don't want you to.
We don't need to be doing that.
I'd be fentanyl laced helium or something.
Well, so there you go. And there goes the payload.
Oh man, you forgot to attach the thing to it.
Well, let's hope that doesn't happen.
That's funny. When I first saw the picture you showed me with all the boxes of the balloons, and the, I thought you were going to tie that many balloons to it. You know how they do,
right?
50 balloons together.
Yeah,
that,
yeah,
that would actually be kind of cool. The weather balloon's a better idea, though.
I mean, so that's pretty much the payload. We still need to put the camera in going sideways, and you know, throw in Jim's device and the battery pack. But all that kind of just gets put in, you know, and then taped down. And it's pretty straightforward.
It's awesome. The whole project is awesome.
Yeah. It's going to go up to space, and we're going to get some really cool images. You know, stuff like this. I made this one 10 years ago, and, you know, I framed it. I have – let me grab the other one real quick.
And I think that photograph you said just came from a simple point-and-shoot camera. Hello? Alyosha is pretty handy. He rigged up a point-and-shoot camera on a timer to take those photographs, right?
Yeah, this was like one of the – so this is the other photo right here.
Wow, that's awesome.
I think that was on more on the way down, and we think that this up here is part of the balloon, but we're not sure.
Right? I'm pretty sure that's a UFO.
I mean, it's a Death Star. But no, I think it's a part of the balloon. And then here is, you know, another cool shot.
Definitely curvature.
Yeah, definitely curvature on that. And you can see the atmosphere as well, which I think is pretty cool. And yeah, this was done with one of those disposable, like, roll-up cameras. We connected it to a 2.5-minute timer. So every 2.5 minutes, it took a photo. And we got 40 photos on the way up.
So, Angry Junkin German's asking, do you have any idea what the first project or two will be? From what I know, the Sky 360 project is kind of has been on the list for a while, right? If you go look at,
pretty sure that's on the list.
Yeah, they create these stations that have the cameras and other sensors, and they're all linked together. And you can go to Sky 360, and they've got a map of all the locations where the cameras are located, where the little stations are located. And so I think that's – I have talked to Chris a little while about it, or Alyosha. But from my impression, that's one project that's on the list. I'm sure there will be many suggested and probably voted on. I'm not sure how that's going to work. Do you have an idea, Alyosha? How the selection process will go of the projects.
Give me 1 second. No, I'm actually sending Chris, though, a quick email to see if he wants to join, if he has time.
Okay.
Or something like that. But I think he's busy at the moment. But I just want to send this message out real quick.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know that it's just going to be, you know, an ongoing thing. So there's going to be more than two, actually. So you might have an initial push for the Sky 360 stations, and then as that becomes the norm, you'd see other projects pop up, suggested and pop up as, you know, as the demand for the science, you know, desire for different projects. I imagine there's going to be some selection process that should be interesting to watch. But in
from
any
what
event,
I understand, and I don't know anything. Meaning I don't make the decisions, and what I say right now might change, is people are going to have the chance to submit their proposals to basically the people that are part of the UAP Society. And however, I'm not sure, there's different ways to be a member of the UAP Society and how that works, but people basically will be able to be on the Discord channel, and they'll be able to either vote up or vote down different projects and things like that. And so depending on how the community views your project is what will happen with it.
Okay, so what Elena Campbell's saying is that those with NFTs, the NFTs sold for the project, will be able to make proposals and cast a vote. That's pretty cool. That's a pretty cool democratic system.
Yeah, it helps out. I think ideally, though, we want to be able to have anyone that's on the Discord channel make the vote, though.
Yeah, no, she's just saying from what she's heard, that's not like a definite. She's not making any claims.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think I have heard Chris say that, though. They're currently about 1/6 of their goal. Yeah, I checked earlier and it was about $950. But the overall goal is, you know, obviously much higher as far as the capital funding needed.
Well, we ultimately, Space Balloons is our first attempt. Space is not attempt, but our first mission, right? We're doing this balloon. It's got some equipment. And when I say it has some equipment, it has equipment that's been designed by an engineer physicist who's been working on this stuff for a long time already. Very accurate, awesome equipment that measures spikes and different types of EM frequencies and things like that. And basically, that's our first mission. We have this balloon going up May 27th. At the end of June, we're already planning a second mission. Again, dual launches, most likely Germany and also the US, potentially another country if anyone else wants to join. That's what's so cool about this too, is you can join. If you have the capabilities and you have the skills and you want to join and do a launch, join and do a launch, right? We can work together and have multiple launches throughout the globe at the same time. But point being is we have another launch in June already scheduled. But depending on how much capital is raised, our goal is to send up at least 3 microsatellites for near Earth orbit, right? And so each one of those is about, I think, $500,000 or so. And so we need a couple million bucks, and we'll send up some microsatellites, and they're going to be measuring basically gravitational waves, as a very simple way to put it, in the easiest, most layman terms ever, right? And that'll help us track UAP and things like that as well.
So you'd have to have multiple satellites to triangulate the...
Exactly. You need to triangulate things. One satellite's good, but you'll never... Two is even better. Three is better than that.
You have to have a laser going between... Some kind of laser going between the satellites or whatever.
Yeah, but that's kind of in the talks, but, you know, it's not finalized or anything like that.
The NFTs will be shift drop on the 27th, Elena. That's all part of the big plan. This balloon launch is part of that.
I think the 27th is when you can officially like get on the list and maybe get them. But I think the actual mint day might be 10 days later.
Okay.
I'm not sure though. Chris has all the information on his, you know, on his YouTube channel, and also I think UAP Society. He's putting videos up there now. So
yeah, but that's why I put the links. Elena, I don't know if you know about the GoFundMe. I put a link to it in that Chris started for the project. It's there.
Yep. But so, I mean, that's pretty much it. As far as what I was going to, what I wanted to show today, we have the payload getting built out. Got the balloon system. Talk a little bit about the project, you know. And I think awesome. It's pretty cool. Yeah.
Well,
I would build more of it right now, but I don't want to touch the balloon until launch day.
Is it sensitive to oils on the skin or something?
Yes, very sensitive to oils on the skin. Okay. So I basically have, that's what I was saying earlier. I probably should have put these on, but I have these cotton gloves, right?
Yeah, that's neat. Yeah,
so launch day, whoever's holding the balloon is wearing a set. Valve guy might wear a set.
You're gonna need a lab coat for the launch, you know.
Not only that, but a badge for recovery. because when I go recover this thing, it could be in someone's backyard. And so I need to basically
almost like a uniform.
I'm here to pick up the UFO. You didn't see anything.
Yeah. And you
know,
mace, so
real
mace,
serious badge looking all clean, you know.
Mace for the mountain lion and bears.
Yep.
I used to carry those poppers. It's a pin popper for bears because we used to go backpacking a lot in bear country.
Right.
It's like a little pin, and it's a little miniature flare. And what it does is it shoots out about 50 yards and then phew, and it scares them off.
It'll scare you too? So you guys both run away from it?
Yeah.
Equal sounds like and a opposite.
Yeah. You know? For every action, there's a reaction, right?
Yeah. No, it's not, yeah, that's pretty cool.
Black, I've never heard of black, those. Black suit and sunglasses. That's funny. Yeah, you should. Well, you might scare people. You might want to have a friendly uniform, you know.
I'm gonna scare people.
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding.
That's what everybody
is. No, I'll probably just wear my normal clothes, like whatever I'm wearing that day is what I wear. I think we actually have some UAP Society T-shirts being made that will be out there. So potentially, I'll be in a UAP Society T-shirt. Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, we'll have a couple stickers. They'll be going on the payload. Oh, I can do one more thing right now. Keep building it just a little bit more.
Okay.
Yeah, let's do that. I'll put
the link. Did you text Chris, or were you supposed to wait on him? Or
I sent him a link that you sent me to the StreamYard. There was no like confirmation or anything like that. It was just like, okay. Hey, we're doing this. People have questions.
Yeah, I thought he was in a meeting. That's why I didn't send him the link.
No, yeah, totally. That's what I was basically saying. If you're free to join, then join. If not, then don't even worry about it. You know? So the importance of wings, not Red Bull. That was a bad joke, you know, because Red Bull is to stabilize this during flight, right? So basically we have these wings and you can see that they kind of like stick out like that is ultimately what's going to happen. And the easiest way to install the wings in the way that's been recommended by the people out in Germany, Stratoflights, is to get my fancy toothpicks, actually. I have one more somewhere. I need to find that real quick. Let me get one more. Artisan, you can entertain people.
Okay, so Angry Drinking German saying, or asking, how did you guys originally meet up with Chris and Lou? Let's see. I don't know the exact timing, but I had met Alyosha and Chris independently and interviewed them separately at first. And then I got them together in a round table with Lou. That's how I met all three of them.
Well, we did a couple round tables, just you, me and Chris.
That's what I'm saying. I met you guys first.
Yeah.
And because when I contacted Lou, I said, hey, I want to do a round table with you guys. And I think they liked that idea. And I guess I did one interview with Lou by myself, but then what I really wanted to do was a round table. And then that's what happened after. So we had two interviews with Lou.
That says 8 in my head. That just makes me think 2-6. I do all the work in my head. I've been designing stuff for a long time. So I don't really like, I don't know. I do by eye. You know what I'm saying? I'm just kind of like looking here.
Now, see, I'm anal. I would have drawn all this up in SketchUp first, but that's no fun. It takes all the fun out of it.
You don't need to do all that.
I know.
One at 2 and 1 at 5. 2 and 5. Those are my numbers I'm using. Right? So that's there. Now we come back over here. I'll do the same thing. 2 and 5.
You need some of that. What's the glue, PL glue, that sets up really fast?
4.5. Perfect. 4.5. Perfect. I'm just double checking. But 4.5 is good. And 4.5 is good. All right. So basically, this is almost the easiest part, but I might end up taking this apart too. This is kind of just so we have it.
Gorilla glue, that's right. Can't beat that stuff, man.
What?
Gorilla glue. I actually am careful where I use Gorilla glue because it's almost too permanent.
I'm not that big of a fan for some reason. I think it's because I want it to dry faster.
Yeah. I'm just saying, like, if you glue wood like subfloor down or something like that, or you're going to tear up the wood before you get the glue, you know, before you get something apart. I always like having the option of taking things apart. So I'm honestly not a big fan of gluing too much. And people say that in my woodworking videos, oh, you should have glued that. And I was like, dude, I want to be able to take it apart. You know, most modern glues are stronger. The bond is stronger than the actual wood. So you can't, if you try to take something apart in the future, you're just going to tear up the wood trying to get it apart.
Definitely. So, I've definitely noticed that.
That's like when I was making those windows, I got flack for not gluing the frames together. And I was like, no, I like being able to take it apart.
There's my toothpicks with my camera. That's going to be the GoPro side.
Oh, I see you're using those toothpicks as dowels. That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's actually really simple to make these wings, and then you literally just tape them to the bottom.
Oh, I thought you were going to shove them on into the end.
No, when I first started watching, the construction of how they do it on their website, they had like a really cool video, very nice, quick cut scenes and stuff of how they make their probes. I definitely thought it was going to be used as a dowel, but then it wasn't at all.
Yeah, that's just the woodworker in me thinking that this actually makes more sense because you don't get damage to the styrofoam.
Right. Well, and that's where.
But you could just end up splitting it if you weren't careful. Yeah.
I want to make sure that I'm not gonna like really, really tape it on. I'm just gonna put one strip right now.
Just to kind of show how it goes.
Yeah, just so people can see as well. Yeah.
That's funny. It's gonna look like a little satellite when you do it like that.
Yeah, this thing's awesome.
We need some solar panels.
Well, this is also sticker territory. If anyone wants to make a big donation on GoFundMe, I'm just going to speak for the company.
Yeah. The board members will be like, what did you say?
You'll
be getting a letter.
What's that?
You'll be getting a letter from the board members. What did you volunteer to do?
Hey, I said they can have sticker space right here on this wing.
That was one of my ideas. Remember putting stickers on the – I said balloon, but then I realized the balloon was not probably a good idea.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure
– I want a sticker on there. I think the people in the chat should vote on it. They should say, yeah, Artist Antonio should get a sticker. And then it will be up to public demand thing.
Well, I bet if you set up enough awareness – of the Artisan Tony sticker campaign.
Well, I donated on GoFundMe.
I'm just joking.
No, I'm just kidding. See, Elena votes yes. So I think Elena has voting power. I can already tell by the way she speaks. She's too knowledgeable.
I'll probably end up turning the camera around. Just
literally looks like a satellite. That's awesome. And have solar panels on the wings.
I can draw solar panels in with a pen. A little sticker. That's what we need, is a sticker of solar panels.
That would make it, that would decorate it. That would be like awesome decoration.
Right. So this is, I don't know if the lid will hold everything together right now. It's not taped on, but this will be connected, to the parachute and then the balloon.
I guess if you 3D printed a box, it would be too heavy if it was out of plastic ABS. It would probably weigh twice as much as the styrofoam, wouldn't it?
I thought about that, yeah. Can you see that?
That's awesome. Make it look like a NASCAR, all major all contributors get a sticker. So that's what I'm saying. You could have. Yeah, that was an idea I had, was for sponsors, was to let people put stickers.
Well, that's why I wish I had a UAP Society sticker right now.
You're not going to launch it till the 27th, right?
Right, now, the launch day is the 27th, launch location, Vernal, Utah, Blind Frog Ranch Outpost, 2 p.m. Yep.
You've got 12 days to make donate $1 million to get a sticker on the side.
Yeah, no, it's cool. It's a small step, one step towards getting true disclosure, public action as well, movements, I know there's already a couple of groups out there doing some cool stuff. So we hope to help them out as well. UAP Society, respects and endorses all UAP efforts and green technologies, things like that. I think it'll be really cool. Decentralized science. DeSci.
It's like the pioneers, it's like you're in a wagon and you're going out west. You're pioneering.
bam, GPS tracking unit, balloon, parachute, everything weighed. Let's go ahead and weigh this real quick. I guess that could be fun.
Now, see, if the parachute fails, that thing will just fly itself back to Earth.
I'm just, I think it'll just kind of more tumble all the way down and explode on impact.
I think you got it perfectly balanced. I think it's going to be fine. You just need a tail wing on it. So will NFT funds contribute, or is this funding for space? So the Sky 360 project was just one of the many projects that was put out there as a possible project. It's not the main, you know, the whole point really is to have an ongoing effort and have different projects suggested by funders. That's what I understand. Yeah. Because, I mean, honestly, the Sky 360 thing is kind of a static. It's not very sexy, to be honest with you, because, I mean, I've been watching it, and, you know, it's just day after day of videos of cameras pointed at the sky. So, I mean, there's going to be other effort. And I'm not minimizing that. I'm just saying you want to have a project that, you know, is exciting for people. Then you're going to have multiple efforts going on.
This is Chris's GoPro.
That's my impression.
I'm trying to see what kind of weight we're at right now.
It's looking like about 1,000 grams, all of this.
And that includes a tape measure, a 12-foot tape measure, and a whole roll of string. And then this chip, which I'm saying is kind of like, so basically I said, this is like Chris's GoPro. This is like.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and that's safe because you know that tape is probably 3 times heavier as the GoPro.
Oh yeah, this is the weight of everything else probably. Yeah. Well, I'm aware of that. People watching.
I know. That's why I was saying it for their sake.
Yeah, no, totally. It's
because you know,
overestimation, right? Like I said in the beginning, you want to overestimate the weights.
Yeah.
For two reasons. I mean, because I'd rather have you go up too fast than too slow, and then secondly, I want to make sure it goes up, right? So.
Yeah. Elena, the NFTs, I imagine, are going to be the majority of the funding source.
I think his Ape Man is really cool.
Yeah, yeah. What's funny is I bought one of those little action cameras one time off of Alibaba. Have you ever seen? When GoPros were like $800, those you could get one of the Chinese knockoffs for like $80. It's kind of funny. And so I had several of them.
Right.
But yeah, I was going to say the problem with NFTs, but I don't mean the problem with them. I'm saying the NFTs will be, you know, it's sort of it's a hard guess on capital. If you have a crowdfunded source, at least you've got dollars that you can see, right? The NFTs kind of, well, it depends on how many people and at what price they get the NFTs at. So it's a little bit difficult to predict. But a crowdsource funded, you know, the GoFundMe tells you how many dollars you have to work with right now. So I see the value of both is all I'm saying.
Yeah, this basically shows that the system is at about 1,000 grams.
And that's that 2 pounds? What is it?
You need to tell me right now, because I don't know off the top of my head.
I have a hard time converting grams to
grams. That's what I use my Google for.
Grams to pounds.
I think it's like 460-something. 8 is a pound.
Yeah, I was close. It's 2.2 pounds is 1,000.
How many grams are in a pound, though?
It's 1,000. Oh, so I'll put this backwards. It's 453 grams.
453. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, it's 460. I go high. Go high and you're good.
Yeah, Angry Drunken German says it's cool to be getting in on the ground floor. And that's a real opportunity because, as I was saying earlier, the artwork, everything about the NFT is highly professionally done. There's no... You're talking about one of the premier NFT projects out there.
It really is, though, too. It's not, yeah, because there's real value, not only because there's real value behind it, right? Decentralized science. But as far as like a couple different other things, like there is going to end up being a sandbox space, which is purely entertainment. There will also be, what else is there? There's a couple things happening is what I'm getting at.
Yeah, and it's an investment. It's a cool investment. You know, your NFT can improve in value over time, and it's just a fun thing to do.
I think they're starting off at like $300.
You're supporting DeSci, you know, science, you know, decentralized science, and also in an investment you're getting as a bonus. So that's awesome concept.
Yeah, I'm pretty happy with this balloon probe at this time. You know, I think it's in a good spot to kind of just stop working on it, but it's at about 1,000 grams, and
that's pretty good. See, you got some room to put like an Artisan Tony patch in there.
I don't want to load it. Honestly, I don't want to put anything else
I'm
in
just,
it,
I'm personally. Just kidding.
And the reason I say that is because I want to make sure that helium to go up.
I just think if Chris is getting to put his dirty socks in there, I should be able to get my artisan patch in there.
Well, I don't know. I think that might have just been like a promo comment, and not that that's actually happening.
I'm just kidding anyway.
That's like when you have like I don't even want to say it. You have like the head politician of a country says something.
Yeah.
Like the backup politicians are like, he didn't mean that.
Yeah. Yeah. The guy who's launching the balloon's like, nope. It's coming out at the last second.
That's not going
to
happen.
You might think your socks are going to space, but they're not.
Turns out they didn't make it in, kind of thing. But no, it could happen. And I think it'd be cool. And if it does happen, I'm getting one sock in there. So maybe two socks go up, but I'm getting at least one of them.
I could get some of those little miniature socks, you know.
You get finger, like little finger socks.
Yeah, the finger puppet socks.
Well, that's what I was saying. The necklaces or something like that are, I think, potentially could be a really cool idea. Not only because I already have them made, but because they're lightweight. Like each one's like a couple grams. A set of socks, I mean, we could weigh that. What kind of socks do you think they were?
I mean, they can't weigh more than a couple of grams, I don't think. I don't know, maybe 6 or 8 grams. Wool socks aren't that heavy, especially if you've got the booty socks.
Yeah. So the second I heard we were launching socks, I went out to the store and I bought a whole bunch of different types because I wanted to make sure that we had them accurately weighed. And that's totally a bad joke, but this is probably like your average sock. Let's see, 25 grams.
What?
You can put up five necklaces for every one sock.
That scale is pretty accurate.
47 with those two. This is another sock. But these are like long, long Pink Floyd socks. You know?
Yeah.
So that's a little
some heavy rock. Right there.
Maybe he's just going ankle highs, you know?
That's what I was saying. Maybe they're a little booty.
Well, that's why I have these ones here. These ones have like those little like grippy things on them.
Oh, those are gonna be heavy.
Yeah. So this is a different type of sock. Weigh that real quick. Yeah. It's not that much more though. It's only 28 grams. So I'm gonna say the sock will probably add at least 20 grams. So 30. 30 is the number I'm using.
But you're still not up to 2 pounds. I mean, 4 pounds yet.
No, we could set up a whole like 6-pack.
I wonder what you could sell this each can for like $100,000.
A box of Hanes underwear or something. Yeah. And like film it and they can use it on their commercials.
There just has to be something that shows up on eBay later for the fundraiser. You know?
No, that's cool. I mean, so yeah, payload looking good. Helium acquired, helium system. Acquired, created, GPS. I at least have two of them activated already, two of the three. So that's good. Maybe I don't use the Strato tracker.
No, I would use all everything. I would use all of it.
It's just a headache. I don't know why it's not syncing.
Redundancy.
Yeah, but it should have already synced. I went and got a new SIM. I put it in there. You know, I made sure the PIN was deactivated.
Heck, all that. I'll buy another one of those trackers that you've got mounted on there. I'll give it to you.
Well, I mean, we have the three. I think ideally I just need to get this one up and going.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you have any doubts, you know.
No, and honestly, I feel more comfortable with the Find My Phone app so far because I did a thing with the Spot 3 tracker, and that one.
No. If this thing gets lost in the mountains, there's no cell phone service. I've been backpacking thousands of times and I've lost cell.
Well, that's where Spot 3 comes in handy.
Right, but the cell service, Find My Phone's like, you know, that's like the last ditch.
Yeah, Spot 3 in the city is awful. It's kind of what I'm getting at. If there's like wires, if there's buildings, if it's inside or it falls like right next to a fence, that Spot 3 is not going to do anything.
No, right. But yeah, neither is the. Yeah, but that's where the phone, that satellite tracker will work in the woods when the phone won't.
Yeah, no, it's that the hardest part in quotes of this entire operation is going to be retrieval.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no question about that.
But hopefully we'll get enough footage before the phone signal is lost.
I think we'll get footage up to about 5,000 feet, easy.
Oh, you should get footage up to like 30,000, I'm thinking.
Maybe.
That's what we should do. Oh my gosh, I just realized a way to raise money. I should do a giveaway, and we should have like, it's almost like betting, you know, have odds on where the phone's going to give out.
I thought about that too. I think that would be fun.
All the money go towards, you know, the GoFundMe.
I'm pretty sure one of the devices that we're putting in there is going to be measuring GPS, like accurate GPS location, as well as like the EMF frequencies and stuff. And so like that one, we'll be able to tell you when the iPhone goes out because we can sync the two times together and it should have altitude.
That's right. The Raspberry is going to have all that stuff on board.
I might not put that in.
Huh?
I'm not going to put that in if we have the other device going up.
Oh, okay. I gotcha. But yeah. his is based on, I'm pretty sure his is based on the Raspberry build.
Pretty yeah. Sure. I'm not very familiar.
They're basically just little boards.
No, I know that. I get that. But like, I don't want to complicate the system. My goal is to just retrieve footage, essentially.
I'm just going on. Most of the things I say are just trying to be a little humorous, funny. I know my socks aren't going to make it in there. Okay, my boxers aren't going to make it. I just know. Yeah, if it was up to me at the last minute, I would tie my boxers onto one of those wings. And it would
you should
be,
just put it as the parachute underneath.
Be going up at an angle.
Like we could just hang all over our box. I'm just kidding.
Yeah.
That's fun.
Well, I've degraded the live stream enough, I think.
Yeah, no, we don't need to be putting personal garments in the box. That,
wink, wink.
That doesn't... I'm not sure if that really helps the UAP Society. I'm just kidding.
Anything that raises money will help the UAP.
If it raises capital at this point, I mean, I think that's helpful.
That's all I'm saying.
But I don't want to, I mean, how many launches are we going to keep doing that are just for raising capital, right? Like they need to be focused, and that's what we're working towards is actual.
Well, focus. After the NFTs drop, that should be the, you know, the thing, hopefully the major fundraising source.
Right? It's definitely initial funding. It's definitely initial. Yep.
So,
but yeah.
Okay. Well, that was fun. That was awesome. I'm glad you let me do this because I wanted to see what you had, what kind of build you were going to make.
Yeah. Very simple build, you know, box, cameras, wings.
So, angry, drunken Germans, what is the one thing you two like to find some kind of answer to? What's the long-term goal, I guess? Well, the long-term goal, really, honestly, in a nutshell, is decentralizing UAP science, right?
Yeah.
If you had to put it into one sentence.
I also want to throw in the goal of removing stigma.
Yeah, that'll be a byproduct.
Yeah, removing UAP stigma. So, like, I mean, everyone has their own goals in life. And one of the reasons I've jumped on board of this is because I want to help with removing UAP stigma. Right.
And so, the stigma is real.
Stigma is very real.
Ever since I started doing UAP content on my channel, and I go into other hangouts, you know, and you know, I get poked. They're like, hey, Tony, how's the prodding going? You know, it's kind of, the stigma is still there, you know.
But it answered, I mean, the truth behind it, though, is that it's just a different, I mean, it's, everyone has their own truths, right? But I guess for my, what I like to say is that understanding it basically gives us access to faster than light technologies and also portal technology. It's a different way of travel. So it's important to understand.
Right. Yeah. I was just trying to put it into, I've heard Chris talk about, Chris has the idea that the main goal would be focused on decentralizing the science.
Well, that's the main goal of the NFT campaign, is right, to decentralize science.
Right.
I mean, I thought
that was the goal of the UAP society as a whole.
Yeah, for sure. But also to have proposals and to do research and projects, you know. So it's
right. Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, yeah, to decentralize it all, and also to put all the information, all the data collected on a database that's accessible to the public.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Because I know that I can't access government data, and I can't access university data.
Yeah, it's just too, the process of getting information from government sources like through FOIA is just too long.
Well, not only that, it's also DeSci.
Yeah.
Long term, it ends up being more of a DeSci education as well. DeFi, no, is it? Yeah, DeSci education. And the reason I say that is because I have degrees or whatever, but like, I never even once heard of electrogravitics in college. I never once heard of a lot of stuff, right? And like, you would assume that if you go to like these universities and you have degrees, I never got an electrical degree, but I know people who have masters in electrical engineering, and they've never even heard of, you know, electrogravitics, right? For example.
Right.
There's secret knowledge basically that just doesn't get taught. And so this is also decentralized education.
It's not even secret knowledge. It's knowledge that's sort of taboo. It's like, You mentioned electrical engineering. You know, most people think that there's no electrical field around, you know, wire, you know, cables that aren't connected, right?
Right.
So there are, you know, but anyway, that's a different.
Well, also, stuff like John Searle, he came up with something called everyone knows the electromagnetic spectrum, right? The red, the blue, all the different colors. But what people don't know of and probably never heard of is something he termed himself. It's called the magnetic spectrum. So how magnets are actually like different colors, and each magnet has a different, you know, different color that it emits. He called that the magnetic spectrum. So things like that are very taboo, I feel like will be a lot easier to access through these.
That's part of the goal. So if that's not accomplished, then that's something you can criticize. And that's criticism is part of the scientific process.
Definitely.
So that's really the point. Can you go to any other scientific society and criticize it as a citizen?
I mean, you can criticize it, but nothing will happen.
Right. That's my point.
Yeah.
You can criticize all you want, but will the feedback be received and acted upon? So. Yeah. This gives you a chance to invest in a project and also have a little say at the same time. So
it's
get a little vote on the projects, possibly.
I'll show a couple things off, I guess. So these aren't finalized by any means, but the way I've seen it is that there's different places on the Earth that act as hotspots for this energy. And the energy is highly related to magnetic vortices. And so what I have here is basically an array of pyramids, right? That increase in size. And what
based on magic squares?
It is based on magic squares. And so basically you end up sending electricity through these different series of ever ascending pyramids in order to create a telescoping effect. And basically, so, you know, I think it's cool that people are sending up this equipment and all that kind of stuff. But I think what's really important is those magnetic hotspots on the Earth. And so what I want to develop is a collimator. And what a collimator does is basically it, if you have a field of energy coming in as a triangle, it's going to continue as a triangle through. But if you collimate the energy at the point, it now is like a laser, right? So now if you have a different dimension orbiting within our space-time, it's going to continue orbiting through our now unless it gets collimated or laminarized. And so you can laminarize the flows of space with these magic squares. It's basically the key for interdimensional technologies and looking through the different layers. So my personal goal, as far as like working with UAP Society and stuff like that, is to eventually get crowdsourced funding for one of my projects. And what's really interesting is I've spoke with Dan Winter recently and other, you could say, theoretical physicists, and we all seem to be on the same understanding and agreement that it has everything to do with rotations within time and how they're all related to certain spacings and how they're all related to the magnetic hotspots of the Earth. So basically, I mean, as far as my goal, I want to create interdimensional telescopes and collimators. And I think that'll really solve the questions.
As someone who's invested in this from the beginning, you'll have access to that funding, or you'll have access to the possibility of funding.
Yeah.
Right. Totally. And that's kind of the point, is to create a system for funding projects like that.
Yeah. But not only, it really has nothing to do with me being part of the community before it even starts. It has, because people that, you know, haven't bought NFTs should still be able to make proposals.
I didn't mean it that way. I meant that naturally you're it's undeniable that, you know, that your voice will be heard, I think, and other people's will be too. Right. Yeah. That was kind of my point. I didn't mean to say you have some kind of special place.
No, I totally. And I think I know what you're saying. And like, I just want to make it clear that, this is as decentralized as possible. And yeah, there will still be people that control different aspects of it, but hopefully it's in like the most, in quotes, unbiased way imaginable, right? So where it's all very like free flowy, you know what I'm saying? Everything's in the open.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You have a better chance of getting funded through the UAP Society than the Galileo Project or some other.
I don't even want to set that up for myself.
Who knows? I should have used them as an example, but I'm just saying.
Say we like
that was the first thing that's the first thing that came to my mind. But and they're doing great work. They're just different. They're just they're
no.
They're sticking to the book when it comes to the scientific method. You know, so
a lot of people like to be on this side of the fence or that side of the fence. I've trained myself to walk the fence. You know.
Yeah. Yeah, so. That's actually a good approach for most things in life.
Yeah, it makes it so. I mean, you it's better in my opinion. You can. Yeah. It also helps you see into the other experience. Like you can.
I was just trying to
a little better.
Yeah, I was just trying to emphasize some of the positive aspects of the decentralized science. You know.
I think it's cool, and I think ultimately it's the way of the future. Everything's getting decentralized. It's just what's happening.
Yeah. All right. Well, we've been going almost 2 hours, which it's been fun. That 2 hours went by fast.
Yeah, that was good. I think that's I'm happy with that right now. You know what I'm saying? Because I'll be arriving in Utah earlier, and I still don't have the GoPro. I still don't have the probe that's going inside of it. So I might not want to make any more cuts. I might want to make more cuts. You know, at this point, I'm happy with it.
And, you want to save some duct tape for some last minute taping too, right?
Oh, I still have plenty of duct tape, so that should work.
Yeah.
Yep. But
that's awesome.
Yeah, if you want to hang out for a minute after you stop the stream.
Yeah, I will. Yeah. Once again, if you guys, anybody who just came in, please check out the links, uapsociety.com. The GoFundMe link is in the chat too. You just have to scroll up because I did them all at different times. And then the UAP Society YouTube channel is also there. So please go check it out. And I mean, as far as the GoFundMe, if you can, you know, if you donated $5, the it's also a measure of support, so it doesn't have to, you don't have to donate $1,000. You could donate $5, and if there's 500 people that donated $5, you see, you know, then there's an impact. And it kind of gives Chris and the gang a barometer, it's, you know, of what of the support. So I want to encourage everybody to do that if you can. Well, thanks.
It definitely helps out. Every penny helps. Yeah.
I appreciate you doing this. It was fun. And I like keeping in touch with what's going on. And it's awesome. It's an awesome project. Can't wait till the 27th. So
I'm excited. I might be hiking through the woods. But I keep, so what, you know, we try to like focus on the best projections imaginable. I'm calling it the hole in one shot. This balloon is going to land in the back of my truck. Right, I'm going to see it coming down from the sky, and I'm just going to, oh, I could just park my truck right there. And I'm going to park, and the balloon's going to land right in the back.
You just need to put a big old rare earth magnet and then a metal plate on the bottom of it. It'll suck it to your truck.
That'd of course,
the camera won't work, I guess. That would be bad, wouldn't it?
That'd be right.
Anyway, I'm rambling. So thanks everyone for watching. I appreciate the input. The chat was great. All the questions were great. And kept the chat going. I appreciate it. So we will see you in the next. Well, I'm sure we'll have another roundtable before then.
That's it.